Okay, so we have three questions each. How about if I start?
Sounds good.
Okay, my first question is, I hear a lot that Christians are saying that science is not the only way of knowing. Have you heard about that, and would you agree with that?
Yes, I think science is a very great way of learning, but I don't think it's the only way that reveals truth.
So what else is there besides that?
Well, I would argue there's historical ways of learning what's going on. There's philosophical ways of learning what's going on. And so there are things that we can determine are true that don't lend themselves to scientific investigation.
Well, okay, so again, this is where, sometimes people say there's a science versus religion, and I say it's better described as scientific thinking versus magical thinking. So when you bring up, there's history as a way of knowing, I would say, well, how do we know what's historically true? And by that, we use scientific thinking, which means you use logic and reason, and you try to come up with the best hypothesis about what happened. So you said history is another way of learning. Well, I would just say that history is basically controlled by the scientific method also, or scientific thinking in general.
Okay, I wouldn't really dispute that in the sense that there you're putting forth and saying, okay, what's the data here? How do we make the best sense of the data? What's the best conclusion? And using reason and rationality to come about that.
Yeah.
I very much agree that in that sense, I wouldn't really. I guess the question would be, what is scientific thinking as you define it?
Well, so basically, yeah, using logic and reason and facts of the world to try to come up with the best hypothesis. And so, in my mind, when somebody says, well, there's other things, I think what they're implying sometimes, and they're afraid to admit it, is that they're saying, well, basically God told me. That's another way of knowing. That's what I'm thinking is trying to be smuggled in here.
Okay, but would you? I was trying to think how to interact with that. There are books that we have that are written down like historical books where somebody just says, "Hey, this is what happened." I mean, we have no way of knowing whether that event happened except that it's said in a book, and then outside of evaluating the credibility of the book. I would argue that when we're looking at the scripture, that that's basically what we're doing. We're asking, is this a book that is credible and worth listening to, and what does it reveal? And so if that's our definition, I would argue what I'm doing as a Christian in looking for where God's at work is very much in that class of using rationality and logic and trying to discern what's gone on and what's the best explanation.
Right. So I think an important principle here is, I don't know who said this, but basically you should apportion belief to the evidence. So the stronger the evidence, the more you should believe it. So in other words, if somebody came to me and said, hey, look at this holy book I just found, it talks about this civilization that existed prior, it could be the Book of Mormon, whatever. I should not say like, oh, okay, well, I'm going to believe it first until it's disproven. I should just kind of take it as I read it and evaluate what I'm reading to see if it looks reasonable or not. And the more it checks out, the more faith I could put into it if I wanted to. But basically, I had to portion my faith or my belief according to the evidence, right?
No, I would agree. I would just say, I assume you're kind of specifically addressing the Bible there. I think that very process has been applied. And so people have looked and asked the question, okay, is the Bible we're reading today the same as what was recorded, 200 or 2 or 2000 years ago? And there's a lot of manuscript evidence that the Bible we're reading today is the same as the one that was written shortly after Christ lived. And then there's, the question of, is there consistency between the authors as to what they're saying? And so there is a lot of that reason and rationality going in and saying, is this a book that we have reason to listen to? And does it match historically other events that are described? Was there a town of Corinth? Was there an apostle or a fellow named Paul who went on these missionary journeys? And to the extent we establish that sort of evidence, then I think the book is worth listening to, whether it makes claims that seem incredible or not.
So we have a common agreement then that if somebody brings to us a book or anything, we should use logic and all the facts that we know about to judge whether that looks like it's true or not. Is that correct?
Yes, I think I don't think there's ever a place where we ought to just say, well, let's just accept this regardless of what the evidence says.
And what if somebody says, well, I really believe it's true because I get a warm feeling when I read it, and I think that's God telling me that it's true. So I have another way of knowing that you don't have, because you're just going on logic and reason, but I'm also going on the feelings of God.
Well, I would be very skeptical of anybody who made that claim personally.
Okay, so because that's one of the things I think that Peter Boghossian, I agree with some of his stuff and I disagree. Have you heard of Peter Boghossian?
I've heard the name, but yeah, again,
he wrote a book called A Manual for Atheists.
Okay.
He's actually local here in Portland. He's a philosophy teacher. And you know, I agree and disagree with some of his stuff, but I think one of the main points he makes is he says that faith is not an epistemology, which means faith is not a way of knowing. You can't say, I know something is true because I have faith. Faith does not tell you what's true or not. Faith is something,
right,
as a Christian, I remember, faith is something you place into something. If you believe it's true, you can place your faith in that, but you can't say you know something by faith, right?
I wholeheartedly agree with what you're saying, yes.
Okay. So when it comes to figuring out what's true, are we in total agreement that the only way to do that is just through logic and evidence and facts? There's no other way? There's nothing else available?
My inclination is to say yes. I hate to make absolute statements like that without having thought about them. But yes, I you know, certainly logic and reason and evidence is, I think that's one of the prime ways of learning about what's true, yes.
Okay.
And so, lacking more in-depth thought about this, I would agree, yes.
All right. So sometimes, I mean, people say science is not the only way of knowing. I guess I agree and disagree. I agree science is not the only way of knowing. It's really trying to say scientific thinking. It's really trying to say science is the endeavor built on logic and building a hypothesis and using evidence. So I think the gist of what they're really trying to say is that scientific thinking is the only way of knowing. And other ways of knowing are wrong. They're logical fallacies. When somebody says, I know this is true because God revealed it to me, sorry, that is wrong. Do you agree with that?
Well, the reason for the hesitation is, I think what I would agree with is that there are effective ways of determining what is true and what is right, and there are ineffective ways of determining what is true and right. And what is true and right doesn't depend on how I come about knowing it. And so, you know, again, I'll ask you to interpret that comment in the light of the context, or in the context of what I just said, and agreeing with you, is that, you know, if you got a bunch of monkeys typing on a keyboard and they type the statement that gravity goes as 1/r². That's correct, whether it was an effective way of doing it or not. So I think there's a great agreement that using rationality and logic and reason and evidence is one of the most effective ways, if not the only way, of determining what's true.
In your personal experience, have you ever really believed something really deep in your heart that it must be true and God revealed it to you and everything, and then as you learned more science or something, you thought, oh my gosh, I was wrong about that? Has that ever happened to you?
Ask the question again, because I'm having trouble grasping exactly.
Basically, a before and after. Was there ever a before where you said, I know this is true because God has revealed it to me so deeply and so clearly, and then later on you learn more facts and evidence and you say, wow, I thought that was true, but now I see it's not true?
I've never had a personal revelation where God's revealing truth to me in that sense. What I have had happen is where I've read scripture and thought it meant a certain thing and believed that, and then come to find out that that wasn't the best way to interpret scripture, or not the only way to interpret scripture. And so, you know, but again, I would, that second line of reasoning is, you know, there's always that looking at all of the evidence, and sometimes I discover new evidence that points me back and says, oh, hey, I need to look at this more carefully. I was looking at things immaturely there.
So sometimes so there's a before and after, where before you looked at scripture and you thought you had a totally correct 100% interpretation, and then later on you learn some more and you thought, wow, my interpretation was wrong.
Yeah, well, I mean, I'll give you an example. Is for a long time, well, for a year or so, I was arguing for young earth creationism, because as I looked at scripture and read the data I had to that point, that these were 24-hour days, and that was the only way, that was the best and only way to interpret scripture. And so if that's what scripture said, that's where I was going to live, because I was convinced that scripture was a book worth listening to.
Right. Yeah, I had the same experience. I grew up as a Catholic, and we just kind of viewed the Bible as totally irrelevant to science whatsoever. And then I became a born-again evangelical, and everybody was believing Genesis literally, so I tried to be a young earther and didn't get all the way there. Then I found out about old earth creationism, like your group, and so that was very reasonable to me. Then I accepted evolution and became an evolutionary creationist, and then finally I thought, you know what, everything just makes more sense, and you have a naturalistic worldview.
Okay. I would think it would be fascinating at some point to just have a deeper discussion. I'm kind of curious why all the details there, but I think that may be beyond the scope of the conversation today. So.
Well, you know part of it because you used to be a young earther and then you went to old earther, so you know that part.
Yeah, and I think the difference for me is I remember very vividly recognizing that, okay, if young earth creation is true and the scientific data is true, that means somebody's got to be missing something here. So there's a place where we're missing critical details that help fill in what's going on here. Because I still, at that point in time, and I still do have a conviction that creation is a revelation from God and the Bible is a revelation from God. And when we properly interpret them, they're gonna match. And so it was, as I continued to study, I found a deeper picture of how to interpret scripture, because I was still fairly new in my journey there. And I've also studied much more deeply about creation and see that, at least as far as the ages of things, there's no real conflict there between what the Bible says and what science finds.
Okay. And so what's your, we can go on to the next topic. What question would you have for me?